Okay, well, thank you, the IoT Forum, for inviting us, or inviting ISMS. We are the guys for the bad news. We are the security guys. We are always bringing all the bad news, and the party ends when we come to the stage. Well, the good news is that Jorge and myself, we've been in this market of security for almost, how many, 25 years?
20-something.
Yeah, 20-something. We better, you look younger than me. So we just were asked to join you in this amazing forum. We're coming from the security and telecommunication. In fact, I was working for Telefonica 18 years. It's a part of my life that I want to forget, but it is there. It is, and I was responsible of security. So every time we were about to launch any service, we were there to put any issues and rejects and all these problems. But talking about IoT,
if you allow me, it was not always the case, no, that we were talking about any new technology and we had some time or space to talk about cybersecurity. So I think this is a very good sign, no?
Yeah, it's a. When I talk to security attack? Yeah, okay. So what we're having in the IoT for us is exciting because, you know, IoT, Internet of Things, is coming through all over the place. This is one of the forums that we do with Tesla. When I showed to some of the CISO, to the security responsible, what is the escape, the landscape of the technologies involved from the IoT, and this is amazing. The worst thing is that not only us, but the World Economic Forum is identifying the cyber attacks as one of the major threats for the evolving of Internet of Things and for the evolving of Internet as we know, no, the society that we know, no. And when we talked about security, I just put this meaning because this is the phase that all the security directors that we know have. This is the technology you have to know to secure the IoT, okay? I know that you cannot see anything. Don't try to do any pictures. I will allow this to, because it's, you know, there's so many, many technologies involved that, you know, the logos are too small. But the good thing is that there is an evolution of many of the vendors that we know that they are trying to catch this space of the security and the IoT. The great advantage that we have now is that you are evolving so fast that in many cases we are like, you know, seat mounts to 1 or 2 years back from you because you are including IoT on everything, no? I mean, that healthcare, communications, cards, you know, anything, no?
Sleepers, so, yeah, sexual toys, no?
Yeah, sexual toys. That's amazing. I just saw one of those. It's amazing. I don't know why you
just saw it, right?
Yeah, I just saw it. I mean, that I would not, no, because it was for the other, you know, it was okay. For the other side. So it's not for my use. So the point is that I cannot think about what's involved in that. Well, fairly talking, I saw a remote IoT, Internet of Things, remote sex, so that, you know, that's the boyfriend cool. Has one toy and the girl has another toy, and they get connected through the Internet, and they communicate.
Okay, okay.
And they have no security at all. I don't think that the guy that...
that's a good idea.
No security in any way, no? but it's true. It's amazing. It's amazing. In some of the cases, I just get surprised why the hell they put Internet or they put connectivity on that. Yesterday, we were in a security forum where we were putting the reality to all the information you share when you activate the Waze, when you activate, when you're using your Android, but be sure that no matter what you do with your Android, and you put, I don't want to share my location, I don't want to share my navigation, I don't want to share my Google Bats requests. It doesn't matter. Android is prepared to send anything to Google. Welcome. Good morning. Okay? So don't think that you're secure because you have all your features on your Android and you configure that. It is almost impossible. I think that we tried.
Yeah.
We've been 25 years on this. You cannot restrict the information that the devices gets from you. It is almost impossible. And most of the times, you control that over the mobile, which is even worse, okay?
Yeah.
So this is a landscape which is terrible. And although this is, sorry for that, because I didn't find out the version in Spanish, but one of the main important things that I was sharing with Jorge that I want to tell you about is that you cannot blame on IoT, okay? The problem on the security, you can blame on the design of the IoT. Most of the presentation I saw this morning, apart from the Samsung one, that I saw the security layer in some way. The first one on the Toshiba, there was many layers, but there were no security layers. What for? We are interested in selling. We don't care about security. That's nice. And that is great. And I would be really love to have, you know, my car. car with all the internet connection, my you know, my plugins with internet connection. But if there is no security, we can do many things. Why? Well, when I see this, I used to say, welcome to hell. When you come to our world, to the internet security, it's hell, because it is TCP/IP shit. Okay, it was designed for the kind of communication you needed when there was a war, when you know the USSR tried to you know, was under threat in on the USA. So the USA invented a protocol to survive to a nuclear war. So the protocol has no security at all because it was a survival protocol, and we just build that anything on top of that. So the bad news is that shit. The good news is that's very flexible. Okay. It's so flexible that you can build that anything. Anything that you can imagine, you can build it on a TCP/IP. But it's pure shit. Nobody cares about, you know, remember the Tannenbaum and the OCI stack? How many of yours are familiar with the OCI stack? One, oh, that's great, that's great. You know, in our world, on the internet world, they are so young that they don't even know what's that. They don't even open the Tannenbaum book, you know? We both started, yeah. but TCP/IP is shit. HTML is shit as well, because it was built for, you know, those scientists on the CERN lab in the Switzerland, okay, to interchange some experience and send technical information, sign information. There was no login page. Hey, hello, good morning, good news. There's no login page. We invited the login page. So anytime you try to identify your IoT device or your web device over a login page, we just put some shit there, some cookies, some information on the PC that all the hackers could retrieve, because it was not designed for that. And this is very important. You are building now operating system. Please, you have an opportunity. Don't use Microsoft, please. Don't use Windows, because if you do the same that Microsoft did, it's going to be the same result, okay? If you know the guys, I used to say that in Spanish, Guillermo Puertas and Esteban Trabajos, which is Steve Jobs and Bill Gates, you know, these two guys, you know, because in Spanish it's not that sexy. Bill Gates did many great things. And one of the greatest things he did, because he controlled the hardware, you guys control the hardware, please do the same that did CPU did, is what, that the operating system was tied to the device. There was nothing in the middle. Of course, Bill Gates took the patent of the IBM, the personal computer, which was great, because everyone was available to have a PC at a reasonable price. That's good. Having PCs cheap, that's great. But the layer between the operating system and the hardware is shit. And we're suffering that for version 8, version 10, or version 1000 Windows. We don't care, okay? So this is important for you guys. You have the devices, you have the opportunity to build up the operating systems and the controllers for the security.
For me also, Juanmi, I think it's important that IoT has this distinct ability to mix the real world and the physical world and the cyber world. So we were used to deal only with the security of the information. Correct. Just some years ago, but now we're talking about that everything is connected. So when we're talking cybersecurity on IoT, we're talking maybe about the cybersecurity of a water treatment plant, for instance. And maybe a hacker can get into the water treatment plant because it has some IoT devices, and they can change the chemical composition of the water that is being drunk by 3.5 million people. Yeah. And this is not science fiction. This happened last year in the US. Okay, so it's something quite scary, because they can poison the people from a computer. We're also talking about medical devices, for instance. Yeah. We could see of course, there's a lot of value on maybe, I don't know, after an operation, have a heart pacemaker which can be configured with Bluetooth. No, it looks like a nice thing, because they don't have to open you up again to do something. Okay, but there was this security analyst that was installed one of these things, these heart pacemakers, and she discovered an awful number of vulnerabilities on her own heart pacemaker. So yeah. it's no joke. So you can be killed because someone forgot to put security on an IoT device. So it's very important. Right. Or maybe we're talking about some mundane things, no? Yeah, yeah, like, yeah. For instance, toys.
Yeah.
Oh. We're giving our kids things that have cameras, have mics, have a speaker. And maybe one hacker can get into these devices and talk to our children and make pictures. And yep. This is also not science fiction.
No, no,
this is
true.
Happening now,
that's
with a lot of devices that are going to the market and that we're buying. Yep. Okay, or maybe people can get killed, no? For instance, we've had several examples of the connected car and automotive IoT, yeah, in which the hacker remotely has got into the ECU and maybe modified the way that the steering column works and crashed the car. This is not science. Yeah. I'm not making this up. Yeah. These are real life examples of things, yeah, that are happening. So
in
for
fact,
me,
many, yep. Many of those examples, there is a TV program that we collaborate with. It's in Antena 3 TV. You have it online. It's called Hacke en la Red. I'm sorry for the Spanish, but it's that. And if you had the opportunity to have a look at that, there's many of those examples that there are there. And this is what I did. The bad news is that I really love the IoT environment and world. For me, it's great to see that anything is going to be able to be controlled, that IoT becomes having a more specific role in our lives. The bad news is that if you, many of the vendors that you're here, or user, or telcos, don't put the security by design on that, and just wait for, you know, those 5 or 10 minutes to do that, because I was just about to mention apps, applications, it's going to be dangerous. Because when water down are involved, when cars are involved, when nuclear power plant are involved, with many plaques from home that have the devices connected to hospital, you know, hospital healthcare are involved, it's when the film gets from comedy into the horror film. Yeah. So this is, you know, this is not something that it's good to hear, but the nice thing is that if you invest a little on the security by design, if you just involve in some of your teams some security staff, or you just go to a market and see what are the opportunities, there is a lot of to win. We know that it's putting money out of the budget, you know, because you're going to have, you know, one of the vendors had to follow the other vendor portfolio and other stuff. But, you know, believe me that at the end of the day, it's going to be more profitable, because going back to the toys one, one of the toy makers that put that vulnerability on those toys for girls, for, you know, these small toys, it's almost out of the market, because you know, they're having problems. They're being accused of pedophilia. They're having a lot of issues, because the server where all the videos were stored were open, so there was a lot of pedophilia maniacs that were coming there. This is true, and taking out those pictures, you know, of the baby girls playing with the toys, and publish that on pedophilia websites, which is on the deep web internet, and the deep internet is the reflect of the human, and it's very, very, very sad.
For me, it's also not a matter of responsibility, it's also a matter of business. So imagine that you have a car company that manufactures cars, and you have to do a recall of, 1 million units, 2 million units, because your cars can crash remotely, and a hacker can get into the car. So it's really a business issue that should be considered. Yep. Just invest a little in security from the beginning, because if not, it's going to be very costly. Okay, yep. And there are many examples.
Any of you have tried a Tesla? I will ask if you have a Tesla, but, you know, it's 150,000 euros, so I don't think that many of us have a Tesla. But have you tried the Tesla app? The Tesla application, when you can park in, you can stop in, you can block in. It's just, you only need the serious number of the car and username and password. You have an Android that is as anonymous to be killed remotely. Okay? If you have an iPhone, you have more possibilities depending on the strength of your password. Okay? I'm not going to ask you how many of you use password less than 5 characters. I'm not going to ask this. And I'm not going to ask when it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You know? Not gonna, okay. So I love to talk about this cloud and IoT. Okay. You know, the picture is quite self-explaining. Okay. But what happened with the Mirai botnet? Are you familiar with that? The microwave attacks, what we call it, the refrigerator attacks. Okay. So this is one of the issues, the main issue that we're having. Okay. So the Mirai botnet was nothing that sounds unfamiliar to us, because we are very used on the internet or financial to have botnets and to fight against botnets. But the problem with the Mirai botnet is that infected IoT devices, mainly microwaves, mainly refrigerators, and there was one guy that just pointed all these thousands of millions of devices against one DNS server, which is one of the shit things of TCP/IP, okay? So he just pointed to that, and you know what was the result? Google was out, Spotify was out, Uber was out. So it affected many, many of the huge, Amazon was out, many of the huge internet players, cloud players. So when you combine those three things, the results should be crash, okay, and the end of the world. And I just, this is kind of joking, but I'm going to say that serious today. Making jokes about the end of the world because of the IoT, if you think about the previous presentation when someone said that by 2020 there's going to be like 20 billion devices connected to the internet, think about where are those devices. Those devices are medical, those devices are cars, those devices are planes, those devices are nuclear plants, water plants. So if you can take control in 2017 of all the devices with this botnet, why do you think that in 2020, if you don't take seriously security on the IoT, will not happen the same with those 20 billion devices?
Okay, it's in my opinion, it's even worse. Okay. The thing is that many of these 20 billion devices are not built with security in mind when they were built. So there can be the case that when you try to put security on devices that are already bad constructed or designed, you simply cannot. Okay, so it won't be possible to patch or to fix those devices. They are insecure by design, and this is something that we see every day. Okay, so.
In fact, it's, I think that I need it to again. Or you turn it off? Okay. In fact, there's one funny thing, which there is a lot of kitchen devices in the United States that if you don't get plugged into the internet and upload it before use it, you cannot use it.
Of course. It's that won't be an option. The devices that we will buy in the future will have the connectivity built in, and there won't be any switch off. So we can disconnect from the internet because all the vendors get a lot of information, and as you know, information and data is now money. So there's a lot of information and of value. So they will include this, yep, whether we like it or whether we, yep, pay for it or not. It will come pre-built.
Yeah, one of the things that I loved about security and cloud is that, and IoT, is that if you like Star Wars, you remember this this force shield that they were using for protecting against the attacker. So the cloud protection is now offering a lot of security services that you can use as long as you are using TCP/IP. Think about the possibility also of using the security services that many vendors are offering in the cloud, because most of the times you can rely on these already proven shields that we've been in the market for almost 25 years that we've been in this market, and you don't have to care about that. But please think about the security. This is a more important thing. I mean, there's not going to be IoT evolution if there is no security. For us, it's pretty clear. I have a lot of things about the BNB, but it just be conscious, okay? Because, you know, this is one of the examples I just put it, but there is many, many things. This was for the water as well. I remember that. Okay. So all the water cycle is completely controlled against that. I remember we have a case in Chile where an unfaithful employee, when he was fired, tried to get connected through the VPN that was connected to an IoT and a SCADA device that was about the controlling of a valve that has the power for 10,000 liters per second. If he wants to revenge because he was fired. So if he was able to activate that, thank God that we catch them on time, probably he will be killed in several villages there in Chile. But that's real. That's another real story. Okay. But I don't know if we are running out of time or we are. I think that we run out of slides.
I don't know. They look as if they're already scared. No, someone has any doubt any question, on the importance of security on IoT? Please raise your hand.
Yeah.
No.
Well, this is supposed to be a panel, so you can ask.
Okay. No, I would like to also get into the our analysis, no, on why is this happening, no, and what are the ways that we can contribute, and particularly as ISMS, mm-hmm, to solve this problem, no. And the first thing that I would like to put here for debate is who's to blame, no, because we say that IoT devices are not secure. I've seen mainly three stakeholders that usually the people have a tendency to blame. The first is the user, believe it or not. When for instance, we say that IoT devices are insecure, for instance, for Mirai, most of the hacks came because the user didn't change the password.
Yeah.
So who's to blame? Is the user really the one that should have changed the password? Maybe so, no? But yeah, there are many vendors that put a mandatory password change when you use the device for the first time. Mm-hmm. And that's very easy to do. And that forces the user to put another password, okay? Mm-hmm. So I don't know. We can always blame the user. It's very easy. We've been blaming the user for 20-something years, so it's nothing new.
It's okay. Not.
Then we have another stakeholder, which is the vendor, no? The manufacturer, the evil. And I've heard you, Juanmi, many situations talk about vendors asking their brother-in-law, no?
Yeah. Absolutely. But the sad news is that, you know, for the presentation this morning, I also see security in one of the vendor security. And so that's the sad part of that. And you talk about the user. We blame on the user for the password, but, you know, once you are selling Wi-Fi devices, once you are selling plug-and-play devices on plugs that you can control, if you force the user to do the upload and to change the power, probably the user is going to put in blank or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, which is something that, you know, you cannot force my mother to upload the microwave, and this is true, and say, I cannot use the microwave, we have to get it connected to the internet, I don't even remember the password of my fucking Wi-Fi devices rooted in at home. So we need to do things that make users their life easy. And just as a trick, or to put some light onto this dark environment that we put in, there is many things to help the user to do the authentication. Everyone, you know, all of us are using mobile devices, and you know, a mobile device can be used to authenticate because you are near to your laptop. Yesterday I saw one software that helped us unblock our MacBook Air for Bluetooth. If you are near to that, it gets unblocked. So you can use your password, but also you can use your Bluetooth device on your pocket to unblock it. So those kind of things make the user friendly life, and it's more secure, because if you rely on the end user to do security, apart from those guys like Jorge and myself, this is a very easy question. How many of you, if you are technical, have activated the MAC address authentication on your Wi-Fi at home? Only allowed MAC address.
Okay,
well, this is a great forum. Okay, there's four people. This is 200% more. This is 200% more than I did than the average. And nobody did that. Nobody did that. You leave it open with the hopefully you had WPA2, but no. Normally you will have WEP. I taught you a trick, because coming from Telefonica, all the routers older than a year and a half are vulnerable to any security devices. So if you want your telco to upload it, that just broke it, okay? Just say this is broken. They will give you a new one with more security for free. If you told them to change, they will say, no, we will not change it. But if you broke it, they will change it for free. It's the only way to upload your security in many telcos.
That's interesting.
No, I did it, okay. I did it.
So basically, Juanmi, the technology exists, so it's available, so the vendors have it, but of course, at the end, it also costs money, no, to add security. It's not free. So you need to pay for experts, and you need to pay for technology.
Yeah, rely on security companies.
This reminds me of an audit that I did a couple of months ago, in which the client had like this horrible situation and posture in security, but had this posture for 15 years. Okay, so when I presented the report to him and I said, listen, this is incredible. You have a very high risk of breach in your network, and they can do this and this and this and this. Okay, and the client said, but nobody has happened for, nothing has happened for 15 years. So why should it happen now? and of course he didn't pay attention to the report, and he continues to be as happy as he was. And the same happens with the vendors and the manufacturers. Unless they're forced by a regulation that can come either from a law, no, like for instance the new privacy law, no, everybody is talking about the new GDPR because it has a fine of 4% of the total revenues of the company. If not, nobody will be talking about privacy, and particularly the service providers. So the other thing is the regulator, no, what are they doing to prevent this? And I think that they're going very, very slow. In some cases, maybe, I don't know, it was maybe 3 or 4 weeks ago, there was, you know, we have this funny government in the US now, which always gives a lot of conversation, no? And we had a representative of the new Trump's cabinet saying that regarding IoT security, they were not going to do anything until something bad happened. And this was a clear statement from this cabinet representative, no? And also said that the industry should regulate themselves. I honestly don't know how that works, no? We have a huge problem. We're putting unsafe products, and when I say unsafe, I don't mean from the cybersecurity point of view. I'm a true believer that we shouldn't be talking IoT cybersecurity, but IoT safety, because IoT touches the people and the reality, no? So from ISMS, we've been working. Sorry?
This in making sense, we're running out of time.
Okay, just a second. Because I think it's interesting, no? We as ISMS, as you know, we are an organization which focused on promoting cybersecurity in the society and in the companies. We've been trying to work a seal of trust, no? Something that we would call like an energy efficiency tag, but for cybersecurity. So whenever someone would go to a supermarket or to a store and buy an interconnected devices, could see what is the security of that connected devices, or at least that the vendor that is selling that product has done a particular set of recommendations, very basic, that would allow the consumer to buy it more or less safely in that sense. So we're finalizing this seal of trust, this certification. It will be something similar to the wines in Spain. As you know, different regions have like different set of requirements. So it will be a denominación de origen, no? And if you saw that denominación de origen, the ISMS forum, then you know that that vendor has passed through a certification process, so you can buy it more or less. Of course, we know that in security, we cannot never have 100% security. But there's something regarding statistics which is 100%. We have 100% chance of designing an unsecure product if we don't think about security. That we can say.
Yep. Okay. That's it. I think that we're done. Okay. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you.